Hi everybody. We're going to look at creating a simple animation with a couple of layers and some sound in the video sequence editor. So let's look at the scene we have first. Simple wall with a door, a chest of drawers, two cameras in the scene, one close-up looking at the chest of drawers, one main camera looking at the wall. I have two scenes here. Let's bring the right-hand fly in into view fully. The drawers and the chest are separate. We've got the frame, we've got the door. We've also, on a second layer here, got a bang, and we're going to animate the bang to emphasize the sound of the door closing. Let's go back to our first layer and do a quick render from the main camera. And the main camera, of course, is the one, or the active camera, is the one that has the triangle above it filled in. I'm hitting F12 because I'm on a PC. We've got a point light coming from the top left here. We can see the shadows from the handle and from the chest of drawers here. We've got a little bit of speckling under it. There's ambient occlusion in the scene as well. I'm going to leave that as it is because I kind of like the effect. And our background is transparent. If I wanted to change this to a sky, I would change under the camera tab the alpha to be sky. Now if we go to slot 1, and re-render, you can see that we have a blue background, and I'm going to jump between slot 1 and slot 2 with the J key. The J key cycles between the slots which have images in them, and we can see the difference. It helps to define the top of the door. We can see the background coming through it, and of course we could also do that in the video sequence editor. We could put a blue background or a realistic sky background, or a photograph underneath this particular image and let the transparency come through. So let's go to the video sequence editor and start work. I've already rendered out two 250 frame sequences. The first scene, which is called Scenes, because that's what I use to render out the animated sequences from first this camera and then this camera. I have a second scene called Titling, which I'm going to use to make the title. There's nothing in that yet, and now I'm going to make a third scene. It's going to be new, I don't want anything from any of the other scenes in it, and I'm going to call that 3 so that it goes to the bottom of the list, editing. And there it is. And I'm going to keep all my video sequence editing in this particular scene. When we click between these, we'll notice this one stays grey. I don't know why that is, but the active scene is always highlighted. It's got this light dot around it. Okay, let's go to the video sequence editor. I would like it to have a preview window up the top, so I'm going to click this third button on the right, and that mixes the preview window with the layers. Okay, let's start to add the sequence strips. It's going to be image because I rendered them out as individual images. We'll start with the eye level. I'll hit A for all, add image strip, and there it goes. And if I hit N with my cursor inside the video sequence editor, we can see the details of this strip. It's on channel 1, or layer 1 as I prefer to think of it. It's starting at frame 1, it's ending at frame 219. I didn't render out all 250 frames because the last 30 or so are actually all the same. So what I can do in that case is to right-click on this arrow on the right side and then just hit G and drag it out to about 250 frames, a little bit over. The reason for this separate color is that it's not expanding or scaling the animation strip. It's just holding the final frame. And if I do the same here and hit G, and then hit G for the whole strip by right-clicking again on the name, we're holding the first frame as well. So I can bring my title in over that. Let's go back to frame 1 again. And you'll notice, in fact, that by default, the VSE, the Video Sequence Editor, has seconds in its timeline, whereas the timeline has frames. This is confusing. I'm going to click View here and just uncheck Show Seconds. So these are all the same. They may not be aligned precisely, but they're both showing the frames, which is important. So frame 50 up here is frame 50 down here. Let's go back to frame one, as I say, and again hit Shift A, image. Going to go up, and this time to the close-up. A, add image strip. This is full 250 frames, and it's just a close-up of that drawer being slammed. This one has the edge post-processing effect around it. This one does not. So we're using a slightly different rendering technique for the close-up. So now I want to add a title to this. I'm going to go back to titling. And you'll notice that although we're still in the VSE, all our edits, all our material has disappeared. Let's go back to the 3D window and start to do some titling work. I'm going to go to top view with 7 on the number pad and add a camera. That camera I want to be an orthographic camera, so I'm going to check that. You'll notice it jumps in size. And I'm going to bring in some text. Again, Shift A, text, tab key to edit the text, and we'll call it goodbye. Go back, move that up into the corner here, and scale it down. I'll just leave the default font. I'll give it a black color, black material here. We'll cut the specularity. The diffuse will make almost black. I'm going to, this time, not use F12. I'm going to imagine I'm on a Macintosh. So I would actually go to the render image up here, and I see absolutely nothing. Couple of reasons for this. The first reason is that we don't have any lighting in the scene. We've created a completely new world. And if we go to the World tab, we go down here, we don't have any ambient occlusion, we don't have any lights, so not surprisingly, nothing is rendering except the horizon color, which is that gray background. So for a start, I'm going to add some ambient. Let's try that again. We just still don't see anything. And there's a clue. If we go to the front view, our camera is at the origin, so it's only seeing things that are below it, and the text that we've just created is on the same level. So if I go to a camera view, we see absolutely nothing. I'm going to right-click to select the camera, right-clicking on the frame, and hit GZZ to move it back locally, and suddenly our text appears, because now we're above the XY plane. Let's look through the camera view again. I want to make this text a little bit smaller. I could do this several different ways. I could select the text and scale it, but you might think that, well, okay, if we select the camera and pull it back, then that's going to change it. But you would forget that, in fact, this is an orthographic camera. So however far it is from the text is not going to make any difference to the size. You change the effective focal length of an orthographic camera by going to the camera tab with the camera selected and changing the orthographic scale. All right, that looks good. Let's render. I'm going to hit F12. I think that's about the right size. I want to save either a PNG image or save the scene. I can use the scene in the video sequence editor. Let's use the scene. However, we want to make sure, if we want to composite this with an alpha channel, that there's actually an alpha channel in the scene. Let's go back to the camera tab. We don't want the sky to be the background, and that happens here. We see the sky as a background. We want it to be transparent. So let's render again, and now we see the checkerboard pattern that's the marker for transparency. So we've got our title set up. I'm going to close this now. I'm going to go back to the editing scene. I'm going to combine these two windows and go into the video sequence editor. Shift A, scenes, titling. So I'm bringing in the title scene, and you can see there it is. I'm going to bring it back to the first frame here. The start frame, I can just do that by typing 1 there. And there's our title. Let's make it 72. Let's make it 3 seconds. Okay, well, I'm not seeing anything underneath this. Why is that? Well, the reason is that we haven't told the video sequence editor to use the transparency in this layer to show the layer underneath. And that's done under Edit Strip in the right-hand fly-in, Blend, Alpha Over. Use the alpha channel in the channel that's over. And there we go. Now we can see our drawer close-up underneath. I'm going to move this strip along, and in the animation sequence here, I'm going to move it so that it starts animating at frame 73. We want to make sure that something's underneath the titling, so I right-click and just extend the opening frame back to the beginning. So now we have goodbye, and then the animation starts. So I've tidied up this window slightly. I've made this preview larger, and we have, for the first 72 frames, or 3 seconds, the title over a still, the first frame of our main camera animation. And then here, these two are aligned. I want to make sure they're properly aligned. I think they are, but I'm not sure. So with the top layer selected, I'm going to cut its opacity to around 0.5. Move forward to a frame in the animation where something happens, which is the same in both. Yes, it is. I'm using the left and the right arrow keys here to preview the two-frame closing of the drawer, and that looks fine to me. So I will increase the opacity of the top layer again, and let's start to bring in our sound files. I'm going to navigate to the frame where the top drawer is completely closed, where the sound is going to happen. Shift A, add a sound, navigate to our directory. I'm going to use the book slam sound that I found on freesound.org. Very useful site for, as it says, free sounds, mostly effects. And I want to play this back when I scrub through the audio. So I check audio scrubbing in the timeline, not in the VSE, it's got to be in the timeline. And when I scroll in, I also want to be able to see the waveform. So let's go to the right-hand fly-in. We're going to pack the sound in the file, in the same way that we do an image for a texture. We're going to cache it, which means it's loaded into RAM. It's available for immediate playback without any perceptible delay. And I'm going to check draw waveform. So you can see the waveform here. It's pretty sharp. That looks like it's going to work exactly where it is. Sometimes there's a lead-in, a certain amount of silence, so you want to make sure the actual slamming noise is aligned with the draw being closed. Let's go back here and play it. Try it one more time. You'll notice it wasn't aligned the first time. It needed to be loaded into RAM, but this second time it looks pretty good. Let's go to the frame now where the second drawer closes. This one only takes a single frame. There we go. So Shift D, G, move that along there. The third drawer, I'm using the right and left arrow keys here. Again, Shift D to duplicate, G to move. Let's go back to the beginning here, Alt A. Again. Good. Now we want to deal with the door. We can't see the door in this particular animation, so I'm going to reduce the opacity to 0. We'll look at the main camera animation. Where is that going to happen? That's going to happen around about there. Again, using the right arrow key. Let's say it comes in there. Shift A, sound, door slam. Add sound strip. I want to see the waveform, so I'm also going to pack it, cache it, draw waveform. And this is a kind of a double slam. Let's see how this works for us. We'll go back a little bit and hit Alt A. We'll do it again because we had to get it cached. Oh, there's a problem. And you can see the problem here. We're running out of time because we originally defined this as being a 250-frame animation, and we've added our title, which has turned it into a 320, 330-frame animation. So let's go down to the timeline, go to 324, 325, that'll do it. Hit E for end. And now when we go up here, we should be able to hear that door slamming in its entirety. Let's try that again with Alt-A. It looks like we're almost done. I've gone into full frame view here with Control up arrow, and I can see the timeline a little more closely. We can see here, in fact, that the first frame, I haven't extended the start of this animation enough, so I'm going to right click on the little arrow there and just hit G, move it over. You'll notice it doesn't change any of the other positions of the animation. It doesn't change the main animation or the holding of the closing frame, just the start. So right from frame one, we have everything looking good. And I'm going to now add the graphic for the door slamming. So I go to the start of the sound here, Shift A. Let's add an image. Remember, this is going to be our ping file, door ping, add image strip. I only want that to be one frame long, possibly two. How long is it going to be? Length 26, let's make it two. It keeps the start position. We also want the blending to be alpha over. So now when we go back in the timeline here and hit Alt-A, we've got a little bit of a traditional Hollywood-style tune animation, the door slamming, and you can see the sound. Control up arrow. Let's go back to our multi-window screen layout, and we're ready to save out as an animation. So I'm in the camera tab over here, making sure I'm in editing. We're half HD resolution. We want to go down here to the output. We don't want to make it ping files this time. This is our final animation. We want to make it something like H.264. You'll notice that the option to save with an alpha channel has disappeared because animations do not have transparency. We're going to save with a codec, and very important, we also want to give it an audio codec or our sounds won't get saved. I'm going to use AC3. This all looks good. Where is it going to be saved? It's going to be saved in our standard directory here, sounds into VSC. I will accept that after calling it final. Accept. And we'll go right ahead and render these 352 frames. Let's go to the last one just to make sure. 352. In fact, that's blank. Where is our final frame? It looks like that's 340. So we'll change the end frame here. 340. Enter. And we'll hit animation and I'll pause the recording. So this is our title sequence playing in VLC Media Player, highly recommended free open source player. First time we've run through it, and we can see immediately some problems that need to be fixed. First off, I'm going to pause this and scrub through it. Not much is happening for the first 6 seconds or so, so we could probably reduce that. Also, we've got a sound for the door slamming the first time, but not for the second. And we haven't used the close-up camera part of the scene. So let's go back to Blender and fix that. I'm going to go back here to our close-up file. Select that. The opacity needs to be animated. It's at zero right now. So I'm going to right-click, insert keyframe. Well, actually, I'm just going to hover over it and hit the I key. That does the same thing. Go to the next frame. Hover over it with the opacity at 1. Hit I. So now we've animated the opacity. And we can do it immediately in the manner of a jump cut, or we can slowly fade it in if we want. I'm going to just use jump cuts here. I'll scrub through the timeline, get to that point there. Now, if I take the opacity down to zero at this point, there's going to be a gradual increase in the transparency, a gradual bringing in of the lower layer over this sequence of frames. So what I want to do here is again hit I to set an opacity of 1, take the opacity down to 0 for a jump cut, again hit I with my cursor hovering over this, so we've now jumped back immediately to the main scene. How are we going to deal with this slow start to our animation? That's fairly easily dealt with. I'm going to hit A to select all, and then G, move things over here so that in fact we start immediately with the main part of the animation. A to deselect, right click, select here, move our titling in. I want to be slightly further to the left here so I can actually select the title rather than the end of it. G, move it over. And I will make the title slightly shorter duration. We'll take it down to 2.5 seconds. So now we've got that. And finally, at the second slamming of the door, I'm just going to reuse this sound. So Shift D, G. In actual fact, I would be better reducing the volume of this. So I'm going to reduce the volume in the right-hand fly-in here to about half its previous amount. And again, I'll save this as an animation, and we'll see if this works okay now. Here we are in the VLC media player again, and let's run through our second revision. So we'll call that a wrap, and if you have any comments or suggestions, please let me know on YouTube. I look forward to hearing from you. Thank you.